I was a young pastor. I am a young pastor. I'm not talking about myself, though. A young pastor who he was a rookie. It was his first year as a pastor. And he was given the opportunity to do a open grave burial. Oh, kids. Thank you, Brittany. If you should follow Brittany, follow Brittany. An open grave burial ceremony. You know, I've never done one, and I'm sure the day will come. It's not top of my list of wanting to do for you. But if it happens, I'll be there. And there he was. You know, he's never done one before. He's trying to drive to the cemetery. This man who really didn't have any family, didn't have any friends. So not a large crowd was expected to be there. And first time at the cemetery, on his way, he just got befuddled and he got lost. And he ended up showing up an hour late. By then, everyone was gone. So he browsed through the cemetery to try to find the plot, and he found a hole with the cement box in it and a shovel by it and some workers under a tree. And so he thought, you know, this is the place where the man was being buried. And being a young pastor, he wanted to preach. And so he went ahead and preached. You know, no one around, but he sent that guy up to heaven in style. I mean, he preached hard and long and passionate. You know, it was filled in his voice. And the only ones listening were the workers under the tree. Well, he wrapped up, closed his Bible, headed to his car when he overheard one of the workers say, you know, 25 years of installing septic tanks, I've never seen that happen before. Hey, life has a way of letting you know when you mess up. Car horns are specifically designed for this, right? I mean, sitting through that green light, we've all done it. And when you realize, if you're fortunate enough to not realize you just sat through it and it just went back to red and you look up, you're off the hook. But if you realize that car's behind you just honking, I mean, it just does something to you. And if that wasn't good enough, the middle finger typically follows. You know, I mean, life has a way of telling you when you've messed up. Problem is, you really don't need the help of others. I mean, you know when you've messed up. Some of you have been labeled, and you've labeled yourself miserable failures. Could have been one thing you did 20, 30 years ago. Never told anyone. And you regret it the moment you did it. And the guilt that sat in that moment has followed you through life. Can't shake it. Maybe something you did last night. Maybe the way you dealt with your kids this morning. Well, you have a way of telling yourself that you have fallen short. Guilt. Let's just talk about guilt for a moment. Where does it come from? Why do you have guilt? I mean, you don't call it out of you. It's an instinctive reaction to something going on within you. Unless you've learned to live with it and hush it up, it will come on its own calling. It will plague you at any moment that it wants to. Where does guilt come from? See, I don't have to stand up here, and I don't stand up here and tell you that you don't steal. You know this. I don't need to tell you lying is wrong. Murdering, don't do that. I don't need to tell you do not sleep with your neighbor's spouse. It's already in here. And yet, the moment you curse out your parents, something, it's like a heavy hand is placed upon you. I should not have done that. Unless you're in the habit of doing it over and over again, and you have learned to live with the annoying sounds of guilt in your mind. I don't have to tell you, do not steal from the bank. The moment you do it, something within you tells you, I should not have done that. I don't have to tell you, you know, worship God. You know, there's something in you that tells you you ought to worship. And until you place that worship on God and God alone, life just isn't right. You see, you go back into Genesis 1 and Genesis 2, God's very image and likeness was your design. The law of God wasn't needed until Genesis 3. But yet it was at the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, that Eve approached and ate of that apple. You see, the knowledge of evil wasn't even in Eve's mind. It wasn't in Adam's mind. It didn't exist. You weren't meant to know evil. But when the bite of that fruit was taken, the knowledge of good and evil ushered in, and God ushered out. But being made in the image and the likeness of God, you had the nature of God imprinted upon your heart. You see, the law, you could summarize the law in this way. Everything righteous about God. And there's details in it in the law. But God's righteousness put on paper. And the only reason we have a law and commands is to show us what we ought not to be in life. It puts flesh and bone on the very nature of God. And this law has been written on your heart. It's like the likeness of God has been removed, but the image has been stamped. And you can't get rid of it. You're still made in the image of God. But now born in Genesis 4 in the likeness of man. Fallen, broken man. So you have the law, the image of God written upon your heart, but no power to fulfill it. Because the Spirit of God, God's breath, was removed from you. And so when we transgress the law, when we break the law, guilt is evidence of the image of God in which you were designed, and it's not... The power is no longer there to fulfill God's righteous requirements. Guilt is proof that God exists and you were made to be like Him. But it's not meant to linger. It's not meant to follow you in life. It's meant to be a tool to redirect your worship back to God. To turn again back to God. And so if you're struggling with guilt this morning, I hope we can turn you again back to the worship of God. We're going to look at Peter. I was told to keep it short. It's just not going to happen. I mean, John 18, 15 through 18 and 25 through 27 is John's version of Peter's denial. And what is it about this story that stirs us? We know it's wrong. The denial of Peter, I mean, we know it's wrong, but have you ever thought as to why it was wrong? I mean, usually the word coward comes out, but is it wrong to be a coward? I don't think there's anything inherently evil about being a coward, running away from bad things. I mean, it's not that he was a coward. He lied. He just flat out lied 3 times. Peter's lies, you could call it. The denial is only wrong because he didn't follow truth. He followed his old self. He lied 3 times about knowing Jesus. See, but I don't have to tell you this. I don't have to tell you that was wrong of him. When you read the story, something percolates within that you can pick out. He should not have done that. And here's what life does. People in life are so eager to tell you when you should not have done that was wrong. But there's a different way for Jesus. There's a different way for him. And it's a way that we are called to. That we're not supposed to pull out the wrong and the evil. We're supposed to re-strengthen each other and redirect our worship back to where it belongs. But people are masters. We are masters at seeing the wrongdoing and then calling it out and locking and holding people in the guilt. And this is not what you're supposed to be doing as a child of God. You have a different purpose, and it goes against what the world says. It swims upstream of the culture of today, where we live in a culture that just calls out the wrong. And all across the board, social media, news networks, you know, whatever it may be, to call out the wrong. But it has no answer for the guilt. It has no answer for the shame. But there is an answer. John 18, 15 through 18. Verse 15, Simon Peter followed Jesus, and so did another disciple. Since that disciple was known to the high priest, he entered with Jesus into the courtyard of the high priest. But Peter stood outside at the door. So the other disciple who was known to the high priest went out and spoke to the servant girl who kept watch at the door and brought Peter in. The servant girl at the door said to Peter, "You also are not one of this man's disciples, are you?" He said, "I am not." Verse 18, now the servants and officers had made a charcoal fire because it was cold, and they were standing and warming themselves. Peter also was with them, standing and warming himself. Verse 25, now Simon Peter was standing and warming himself. So they said to him, "You also are not one of his disciples, are you?" He denied it and said, "I am not." One of the servants of the high priest, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, asked, "Did I not see you in the garden with him?" Peter again denied it, and at once a rooster crowed. The annoying sound of a rooster. We all have them. Those triggers in life that remind you that you didn't make it. You fell short. And for Peter, got a rooster. I wonder if the sound of a rooster at that point on meant, you know, if it triggered this night for Peter. Go back to verse 15. Simon Peter followed Jesus, and so did another disciple. Let's talk about Peter not being a coward. He is in full uniform right now. He is Peter, the disciple. Him and another disciple is probably John. No way to totally verify this, but John refers to himself as a disciple. He calls everyone else by their name. It seems to be John. There's two of them. The rest have scattered, apparently. He's not a coward. He's following Jesus. He wants to be there. If it's curiosity's sake, if it's to charge and storm the courtyards and rescue Jesus, I don't know. But he's following as others are fleeing. Since that disciple was known to the high priest, he entered with Jesus into the courtyard of the high priest. So if this is John, which most people assume it is, his story, his perspective is going to be a little different. He got to see this. He got to hear Peter's denial. And he brings about to the surface what you need to know about Peter's denial that the other synoptics don't necessarily do. Verse 16, but Peter stood outside at the door. John goes in, Peter standing outside. He's not in the courtyard yet. So the other disciple who was known to the high priest went out and spoke to the servant girl who kept watch at the door and brought Peter in. All right, so John sets this up. John goes in, Peter stays out, and there's a young lady in between the two. Young servant girl standing at the door, keeping watch of the door. In other words, filtering those who go in and out. And John comes and speaks to this young lady. No idea how old she is. But John comes out and says, you know, he's with us. He's allowed in. Now, Peter's night has been turned upside down. On a dime, his night has been turned into chaos. His best friend, Jesus, has been just shackled and led away by a bunch of guys that want to kill him. Now, if you put yourself in his shoes, I mean, you would sense the helplessness that is going on in that moment. And his defense is down. He's just trying to figure out what in the world is going on here. And life, when it takes you by surprise, what does Paul say is in Ephesians, that we fight a battle against not flesh and bone, but spiritual darkness. What Peter is up against is greater than these soldiers, than these officers. What he's up against is Satan himself. The servant girl that stands between Jesus and Peter at the door said to Peter, now, maybe she's doing her job. I don't know. She's supposed to filter these guys. But she goes, "You also are not one of this man's disciple, are you?" He said, "I am not." Is it possible Peter, this first denial, lies because he wants to get in there? And if he thought, maybe if I didn't lie, if I said I was a disciple, I would not be allowed in. A harmless little lie in order to get in. But Luke shows you something about this girl I want to pull out. Luke's version says this, then a servant girl, seeing him as he sat in the light and looking closely at him, said this man also was with him. It's the look of the woman. Peter gets stared down in the eyes. I mean, this woman, this young lady is staring at Peter and grabs his attention. I'll tell you something. When someone looks you into the eyes and they question you, there's something about that look, especially the look of a woman, that just begins to paralyze a man. Oh, you don't ever hear it. Did you see the way that guy looked at me? You don't hear that. Did you see that woman's look? I mean, this is set up for Peter to fail. And Peter, so there's this moment between this young servant girl and Peter, the guy who just pulled out the sword ready to take down this cohort of soldiers, and she brings him to his knees. You weren't also with this guy, were you? And look at the way her question is worded. I want you to see this card, just because, guys, the cards are often stacked against you for you to fail. And Jesus at times expects it. You're just not going to make it through this one. I'm going to show you here in a minute what I mean. How does she ask the question? According to John, the question expects a negative answer. Just agree with the girl. It's easier to agree with her than to change her mind. You also are not one of this man's disciple, are you? It's just easy to say no. All three questions are set up this way, and I think John wants you to see something. Peter didn't stand a chance, even if he wanted to. He said to Jesus, "I will never deny you." And Jesus says, "No, but before the rooster crows, you will deny me three times." Now the servants and officers had made a charcoal fire because it was cold. Charcoal fire. Just take note of that. And they were standing and warming themselves. Peter also was with them, so he got in. And he's there with the officers and servants, standing and warming himself. There he is, Psalm 1. Do not find yourself standing or sitting in the seat of scoffers or sinners. It affects you. What are they talking about around this fire? You know, I don't think it was the Monday night football game. It's everything going on right there with that man, Jesus. And those people in the garden with him. Now, we pick it back up. We'll look at 19 through 24 next week. Now, Simon Peter was standing and warming himself. Now he's in the midst of sinners. So they said, we go from servant girl to the crowd. They said to him, it's like they were talking about his disciples. And Peter's overhearing it. You also are not one of his disciples, are you? John wants you to know the questions are structured the same. It's just easier to agree with them. He denied it and said, "I am not." Sometimes there's just nothing you can do in life. You find yourself in situations where it seems like you're just destined to fail. And I want to stand up here and say, no, you can power through it. But Jesus said something to Peter that when I read it this morning, it just blew my mind. You'll see what I see. Verse 26, one of the servants of the high priest. It gets deeper. Now we have an eyewitness there, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off. Maybe his brother, I don't know. Asked, "Did I not see you in the garden with him?" The structure of the sentence is still the same. I think John's trying to protect to some extent Peter. And by the way he's wording this. But now you've got an eyewitness there. His relative's ear was cut off and plastered back on. And he's like, "Well, I saw you there, didn't I?" And we know from the other Gospels, this is where Peter starts calling down curses on himself. "I'll be damned to hell if I was there, if I'm lying to you." He curses himself. What do you do? Well, Peter again denied it. And at once, a rooster crowed. Man, what is your rooster? It could be very well just your own mind. Be a family member. It could be the police sirens right behind you. It could be the creaking of a fridge door at 2 a.m. Man, what is your boss? The list goes on and on and on. Peter again denied it, and at once a rooster crowed. And we know from the other Gospels, he ran and wept bitterly. Now, Judas didn't have an answer for his guilt. He hung himself. And you're here this morning because there is an answer to your guilt. I want to go to Luke. I want you to see something that took place just before this that John doesn't show you, but Luke does. Jesus is talking to Peter. This is Luke 22, just 20 verses before the denial. Peter, Peter, Simon, Simon, behold, Satan demanded to have you. Get the thrust of this. Satan demanded. Jesus, he's mine. I'm taking him. Nothing you can do. He's mine. I'm going after him tonight. I'm taking him down with you. He demanded to have him, that he might sift you like wheat, just blow away in the wind. Nothing left of this guy. Some of you, you've felt like Satan demanded you, that you have gone through the rigors of life when where is God? Evil is all around, and it's found in here, and you just can't do anything about it. But don't forget John 17. Never forget John 17, the prayer Jesus prayed about you. Protect them, guard them, let's bring them home. It's gonna happen. Because verse 32, Jesus says to Peter, but I have prayed for you that your faith may not fail. If you have faith, it will not fail because Jesus prayed for you in the vineyard. John 17 was a prayer about you. Your faith will not fail. And many will tell you it is and it has. And you have to start over. Don't miss the rest of this verse. And when you have turned again, Jesus is saying, I'm expecting you to turn away. He's not preventing it. He's not warning him, don't do these things. Jesus is saying, Peter, when you turn from me and you come back because your faith isn't going to fail, I need your help. You will need to strengthen your brothers because they will be going through it too. Your brothers and sisters in this church will be sifted by evil and darkness. Their faith will not fail. But they need to be strengthened. And if you've gone through it, you know what I'm talking about. You know what Jesus is talking about. Where there's that point where you turn back. We see it in John 21. Peter, do you love me? Do you love me? Do you love me? Feed my sheep. Take care of my sheep. In other words, strengthen. Strengthen the church. Go take care of them. They now need you. You look at 1 Peter and 2 Peter. Those books, what are they about? Suffering, persecution, false teachers. People getting eaten up. Spit up, children of God, taken and abused by this world, and he's strengthening them. He's doing what Jesus told him to do. I've prayed for you that your faith may not fail. And when you have turned again, when you have repented, when you have come back, if you're in a season of turning away, do not be discouraged. You've been prayed for. And when you come back, you have a story and a testimony that is designed and is needed by your brothers and sisters who will go through a very similar season. The rooster wasn't the end. John 21, Peter is out in a boat with some disciples. They're fishing. They're not catching anything. And a man on the shore goes, hey, catching anything? No, not today. Throw the net on the other side of the boat. Throw the net in. Someone counted the fish. I think it was like 159 fish or something. The net didn't break. They bring it in. They realize we need to go see this man. Peter's probably thinking in his head, I think Jesus is on that shore. He gets on the shore and this is what he's met with. Now the only other charcoal fire in John is the fire that had the enemies of Jesus standing around it. There's a new trigger for Peter. When they got out on the land, they saw a charcoal fire in place. Now John isn't just throwing this stuff out there. This is a message in John of grace. That charcoal fire That charcoal fire represented something new in Peter's life, grace and mercy. Jesus never brought up the denial, not that we see. But Peter was strengthened. You see, we all have the annoying roosters in the back of our head. You failed, you sinned, you're not good enough. And it's time to hush them up with new reminders. Charcoal fires, rainbows, the dew on the ground. You know, what is the reminder of grace and mercy in your life? Because that should squash all guilt and shame. We fall short. It's a matter of life. It's going to happen. But the answer isn't found within us. It's found around a charcoal fire. A same fire, a same picture where evil was plotted against the Son of God to kill him. That Jesus brings out a charcoal fire to save in grace and mercy for even my enemies. Two things. How do you deal with others who commit wrongdoings specifically against you? It's easy to call them out, point them out. Let's trigger the guilt. Make them feel bad about what they do. And then how do you deal with it for yourself? Romans 12:20. To the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, someone who has harmed you, wants to harm you, persecute you, calls you to suffer, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink, and for by so doing, you will heap burning coals on his head. I've always just wondered, what does that mean, heap burning coals on his head? I don't think Paul's tying this into John's use of the fire. But I've come to this idea of open shame. You meet your enemy with love, they have nothing else to do except stare at their wrongdoing and try to reason their way through your loving actions and their evil darkness. It's open shame. It burns. It burns within their flesh. Meet your enemies with a charcoal fire of love. Share them. Share with them the same grace and mercy that you have received. It's so easy, I'm telling you, it's so easy to call out the guilt in them, to raise it up in them. But the different way, a better way, is to bring them to the grace and mercy of God as you have found it, as you have been strengthened in it. And a lot of our enemies are very close to us and have the same faith that you have. They need to be strengthened just like you. But for those of you this morning, you just can't shake it. And this sounds good, and you'll leave here determined, guilt will never follow me again. And that statement alone will be the trigger of guilt. And it'll just bring up that memory. Just can't get rid of it. You need to know this. This has got to be turned over in your mind over and over and over again until you feel your bones strengthening under the grace of God. Psalm 32, blessed is the one whose transgression, whose sin, wrongdoing, unrighteousness is forgiven, taken care of, gone, wiped clean, whose sin is covered. It's been covered. Someone else took it. Someone else dealt with it. Verse 2, blessed, how happy, is that word blessed, how happy is that man, is the man against whom the Lord counts how much iniquity? How much wrongdoing? None of it. None of it. So if you're counting it against yourself, then you're not living in the knowledge of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, and how He views you. And in whose spirit there is no deceit. You have a new spirit. God does not see deceit in your spirit. Your spirit is new. It is the spirit of truth. Verse 3. For when I kept silent... Some of you, this is gonna resonate. You've never spoken of it. You just never dealt with it. And you've just wasted away under the guilt. Groaning all day long, silent groanings at night. It's like the hand of God just heavy on you. You have a way to deal with this. Verse 4. For day and night your hand was heavy upon me. The hand of God. You're made in His image. You can't escape. You cannot escape the guilt that will follow. If you know there's a God, then you're aware that in you, that there is a law written on your heart. You cannot escape it, and you transgress it. It's like the hand of God just resting on you. Strength is dried up. It's by the heat of summer. This was his answer. I acknowledged my sin to you. I did not cover my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord. You forgave the iniquity of my sin, the wrongdoing of my sin. You forgave that part of sin that affects me. You forgave it. Washed it away. Therefore, let everyone who is godly. Are you godly? Everyone here, we godly? Offer prayers to you at a time when you may be found. Every time. All the time. Surely in the rush of great waters, they shall not reach him. Verse 7. You are a hiding place for me. Now the one who you've sinned against, you can hide in. This is so backwards. The one that you transgressed against becomes your hiding place to protect you from those in the world who want to remind you of what you did against him. They've got no power. There's no victory in that anymore because you're hiding in the one you've sinned against. He's accepted you. He's forgiven it. He's not counting it against you. And there's others that may be, you know, doing this. But you're not hiding them. What they think about you doesn't matter because you preserve me from trouble. You surround me with what? Shouts of deliverance. This is what we're leaving with today. Shouts of deliverance. Not the whisper of guilt and wrongdoing. Peter left with shouts of deliverance from that beach. That coal, that fire of coal. Jesus made it very clear. It's behind us, Peter. I just got done taking care of it. You get to move ahead. And you get to go strengthen those who will walk through the exact same season you just went through a few nights ago. And if you've turned again, that's my encouragement to you. The temptation will be to call out the guilt in people. But when you are strengthened in your bones, it will be natural to you to approach them, even your enemies, with love. And you'll know you're walking in the truth. You're walking in the shoes of Jesus. Because this is what Jesus did after that cross with Peter. He met him with love. And Peter went and he started a church that you are a part of. Built upon that grace and mercy that he received that day.